what they had to say about each other.
So how do you feel about your match against Monsanto?
I always lose to Monsanto in open tournaments, and I always lose to him in ladder 2.
In spring preliminaries, I played him first 2. Having won against them, at least I know I can do it. So that's, I get that for me.
I'm actually pretty scared to play against him, and I really wanted to avoid him because like, he's a good ladder friend.
We're not bringing the same decks. We're not having the same strategies. If he's afraid, maybe he's gonna play more safe or...
I pretty much like know like what he's gonna bring. Hopefully my lineup targets this lineup good enough so I can have a chance against him.
And he has Zulath. My lineup does very well against Zulath. He also has Druid. My lineup can beat Druid. My lineup can beat pretty much everything.
But I gotta beat Monsanto like in the end, because I need to win.
I have to not think I have an edge in order to play well.
I just wish him like to have fun, but not good luck.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Caster's Desk. That's right, it's time for our second quarterfinal of the day. My name is Frode, and I am joined by the one, the only, the extremely handsome, as always, Brian Kibler. Brian, how you doing?
I'm doing real well. Looking forward to this match. This is really a clash in styles. Monsanto with the super combo-heavy lineup against Hotmail's more traditional styles of decks.
Yeah, it's going to be a really interesting clash, like you mentioned. I want to see who is going to get the better of each other. They mentioned that they've met up and ladder multiple times, even playing each other, and Hot Meowth hasn't really been able to get the best of Monsanto, despite the fact that on paper, Hot Meowth is bringing the quote better decks, unquote.
Yeah, Hot Meowth has a lineup that's very, very sort of typical, with the exception of his warrior deck, which was banned in this matchup. He did choose to ban Monsanto's Shaman. Throughout the preliminary, warrior was by far the most common ban, but what do you think of this Shaman ban in this particular spot?
I like it a lot. I think Shaman has proven himself to be public enemy number one in a lot of people's cases. The data is sort of supporting it at this point. Whether or not it's the strongest deck, people perceive it to be the strongest deck, and that might heavily influence how your lineup is going to function in this tournament.
One interesting thing is that the Shaman deck is the one deck in Monsanto's lineup that is A, not one that he played at the preliminary, and B, not a combo deck.
That's true.
And he said that he feels by far the most comfortable playing combo decks, so you know, maybe he's happy he doesn't have to play it here.
This is one of the interesting things about the fact that every player has to bring 5 decks, Brian, and at one point, you're going to have a deck that you're not nearly as familiar with, and Monsanto just said, you know what, Shaman's really strong, so I'm just going to bring it.
Well, it will be Druid for Monsanto in this game against Hot Mount Shaman, and Monsanto with a handful of kind of clunky cards here.
Yeah, this is not exactly the opening hand you want. Where's the Innervates? Where's the Wild Growths? Even Raven Nighthole's pretty useful early on if you don't have any other plays. In this case, Monsanto is just going to stall out and just kind of bide his time planning out what he can do, but also just kind of accept his fate, because ultimately he can't do anything other than hero power this turn.
And here, you know, while he may only have that one possible option, he's both able to take his time and think about, you know, how the game may play out in general, and also doesn't want to necessarily reveal information to his opponent.
Right.
If you just instantly use your hero power on turn 2, your opponent can very likely decide, okay, he probably maybe doesn't have Living Roots, no other real options he could possibly play that turn.
Definitely. Hot Meowth going to take the very solid option of playing Toshka Totemic. It's been one of the most strong cards that's been able to dominate the early game board. However, just kind of a very innocent healing totem. So Monsanto's not falling too far behind. Shaman is extraordinarily powerful when it's able to start off with cards like Tunnel Trog and Totem Golem and Toshka Totemic when they all compound on each other's effects. But in this case, it seems like Monsanto is relatively safe from the early game.
He is, though. He still is kind of in a weird spot with his hand. He has a bunch of expensive cards in those Giants and Wisps, and his only removal option here is Feral Rage, and that's a card that he'd really love to be able to either use alongside Fandral or potentially use to remove something a little bit more threatening than just this Totemic, but it's his only option this turn, really.
Right, and you have to kind of think about what are the implications if you leave up this Tuskar Totemic. It's not the fact that it'll just do 3 damage next turn, but if you're not going to kill it because you're playing a 4-mana minion, it's going to do 6 damage, maybe even 9 if you're not removing it the turn after that. So you have to be very mindful of it. So even though you don't get Feral Rage on the ideal targets like Totem Golems, it's still something that you have to do.
And this also gives a lot of information to Hot Meowth, because Feral Rage is a removal spell that you don't really want to use in that capacity. You'd much rather use Living Roots and be able to use Hero Power, mm-hmm. or perhaps Wrath it down and be able to use the Feral Rage either for the life gain later or to kill a more resilient minion. So Hot Meowth knows, okay, well, Monsanto must not have a good hand here if that's really what he's doing to remove this card now.
Yes. The only other possibility that could be going through Hot Meowth's mind is that Monsanto also has an amazing turn 4 play with an Innervate.
Yeah.
With potentially like Vile Teacher, Power of the Wild, and Innervate. However, that's much less likely to be the case because Monsanto, if he had Innervate that early, he probably would have put it out.
Yeah, and this play with the Flame Tongue Totem really shows that Hot Meowth recognizes, okay, that Feral Rage probably means not really much removal going on over there. Mm-hmm. It also, you know, Monsanto's not really in a spot where he can answer this and really do much else proactively. Even if he did have, say, Swipe or Wrath here, it does leave Hot Meowth at the board, and Monsanto doesn't develop anything of his own.
Yeah, this is a very awkward situation. You definitely don't have anything guaranteed off the Raven Idol, and even then, playing Phandra on the board doesn't impact much, so I feel like Mire Keeper seems to be the best option here that I'm looking at, and I guess the debate's whether or not you want to put out a token or you want to ramp.
Yeah, Mire Keeper here, it does just die to the Argent Squire, and the 2-2 could just die to the other totem. It does at least slow down your opponent's damage to your face a bit, which is quite valuable. He may look to ramp because he does have just a very costly hand, Wisps of the Old Gods and such. And he will make the totem try to stall this board. And I like this play. He is just kind of in a situation where he needs to stem the bleeding.
Yeah, I don't think Wisps of the Old Gods is a card that helps him catch up on the board.
Not at all.
Cards like Ancient of War specifically function in this deck for that reason. You ramp up to that card as fast as you can, stall into the 10 health buys you time. So I don't disagree with Monsanto's logic there. I think buying more health, essentially, and more time for these Arcane Giants to swing the board is paramount. Okay. That is, you know, Brian, that's pretty interesting placement. I think people, of course, are going to immediately start thinking, was that a mistake to place it not next to the Flame Tongue Totem? Why don't you explain?
Well, this leaves the right side of his Flame Tongue Totem open for totems themselves. He doesn't necessarily need more damage on the Flaming Faces to get through anything. And if there is some minion play that he can attack into, he does have the Argent Squire that can already attack. He also has a Horse Rider in his hand that he can put on the right-hand side of the totem immediately and get damage in like that as well.
Yeah, I think, you know, this is supposed to be the fact that Hot Meowth has an Argent Horse Rider in hand, so he can attack immediately and get that Flame Tongue value. And like you said, because of the way smaller tokens spawn to the right of that totem, you definitely need to make sure to line it up appropriately.
So a Raven Idol 4 Monsanto reveals Wrath looks at least somewhat attractive to be able to deal with that totem, but no answer to the Flame Wreath Faceless, which is really looking to be a big problem for Monsanto here.
Yeah, he's going to take 7 at least from that one minion. If he plays Power of the Wild just as a 3-2, it's not going to do much either. So he just chooses the Hero Power. And Hot Meowth has 3 mana remaining, so I guess the Horse Rider seems to be the best option at his disposal. 9 damage puts Monsanto to 17, and with 9 on the board, that's not much health to work with.
Yeah, really rough spot for the Canadian player. You know, that opening hand has not gotten that much better, hasn't found Innervate, anything to really get things going. And frankly, even if he does, he's under so much pressure. You know, like you mentioned, Wisps of the Old Gods, not really a card that gets you back into the game when you're behind. Similarly, Arcane Giant, without something to give it taunt, is not going to protect his face from all this damage.
Yeah, I know some people who are playing the deck, they think, you know, isn't it important to activate those giants? But the purpose of the Druid is to use those giants after you've committed all of your spells to removing, you can finally play some minions. In this case, giants just cost way too much mana. That is one of the drawbacks. Oh man, that's not going to be helpful.
Yeah, this is just a terrible spot for Monsanto. He is able to get the double effect of Power of the Wild, making himself a little bit of a board, but yeah, he's just still facing down that 9 damage, and is this may even just be lethal here.
Yeah, I think with the Flame Tongue Totem and Lava Burst, that is an additional 9, so that'd be 18, if I count correctly.
Yeah, I think that Hot Meowth, if he does just go for it, the game is over.
just have to triple check to make sure, but I think by our math, it is exactly, it's one over lethal.
Yep. And, you know, Hot Meowth, taking his time, wants to make sure, okay, I am counting this correctly. And he has the time to take,
yeah,
and he has the game Why to not? Take as well as Lava Burst closes things out, and Hot Meowth takes a 1-0 lead.
There you go. So Shaman off the board very quickly, but we kind of expected this to happen. This isn't something that's extremely shocking. Shaman has been one of the strongest decks ever since the final wing of Karazhan has released. All right, so getting ready for our second game of the day. Let's take a look and get to know Hot Meowth a little bit better as we prepare for game number two.
I know you're involved in the Vicious Syndicate, the data report. Talk to me a little bit about that. How did you get involved with that, and how has that sort of helped you with competitive Hearthstone?
I started getting involved in like more competitive this year. I went to the Winter and Spring prelims, and I got to meet like a Vicious Syndicate like guy and like team members there, and like they kind of introduced me to their community. They invited me to like expert classes for their data report article. They shared like the statistics, like what are the like best classes, like class frequency, how like the win rate matchup for each deck. I think that's kind of like calculated luck, just because like I bring like the better decks to have an edge, so like I can have like a 70-30 matchup, so I can increase my probability. But like when you can see like how like the numbers match up, like you can like have an edge, it's kind of cool, like kind of like science in a way, but it's kind of cheesy to say.
In the Vicious Syndicate data report, you're the hunter expert. Why are you the hunter expert?
It's kind of funny because like the reason I'm in, like I was supposed to like fill in temporarily for a guy who was busy, but I ended up being the full-time hunter expert. So I don't play on hunter like too much on the ladder right now, but I did bring it in my tournament lineup. So I'm actually confident with hunter, and I write about it a lot, so I understand like what the concept and what's its state in the meta right now.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Hearthstone America Summer Championship. It's game two of series number two. Monsanto is going to be the one making the look of comeback right now as he's down 0-1. However, keep in mind, it's best of seven, so we're just getting underway. A lot of things can develop over the next hour or so.
And in a lot of cases, as some players have mentioned, what doesn't matter is your best deck. It matters is your worst deck. Your weakest deck in the lineup can really be your downfall. And in this case, Monsanto is really heavily targeting Hot Meowth's Zoo deck. He feels like that is where he will find the weak link in Hot Meowth's lineup.
That's what he's hoping for. We're going to go into Hunter versus the Paladin. You heard Hot Meowth talk about how his journey throughout just the competitive scene of Hearthstone has also led him to contribute to the Data Reaper, which is a very popular report based off the Vision Syndicate crew. And now here he is playing Hunter. So yeah, we'll see if he's truly the Hunter expert.
And Monsanto playing his Anything Can Happen combo Paladin deck. This is a little bit different than the version that he played in the preliminary. I had a chance to talk to him, and he said that the deck with Ivory Knight now, it plays a little bit more mid-range compared to the Lay on Hands version that he played at the preliminary. So it has the ability to win games, not necessarily just through the late-game combo, though that is the primary win condition of the deck.
Yes. In fact, they've definitely scaled back on some of the just the stalling aspect of it. Not even two Forbidden Healings seem to be in the deck, and Ivory Knight seems to make up and compensate for some of that healing, which I do like a lot, because I think with the Anything Paladin, one of the big problems was sometimes you're just holding two Equalities, two Pyromancers, and a Forbidden Healing, and you have the opportunity to take initiative. You just don't do anything.
Yeah, the fact that the Ivory Knight allows the deck to play more just to the board instead of just being a purely reactive deck definitely causes the games to have a little bit different of a sort of texture. And one of the interesting cards is another addition is Barnes. Barnes came, you know, obviously from one of the later wings of Karazhan, then existed during the preliminary, and be able to Barnes out even just an extra Murloc can be a huge deal in terms of your damage potential, let alone getting something like Tyrion Fordring.
Yes. In fact, there is this weird instance where having five guaranteed bluegill warriors is better than just the four that you would get off the second one. So it's a lot of these things where Monsanto definitely will be looking for Barnes as being one of those heavy mid-game lifters. He has some of his clunky heavy game, or late game, excuse me, with Tyrion and Ragnaros. Not exactly what he's looking for just at the moment. And what you can interpret is that he's just going to be looking to draw cards. And that's why he has his Acolytes of Pain, his Loot Hoarders, and the Solemn Vigils.
Yeah, this hand, not really what he wants at this stage, but does have, you know, obviously access to his hero power plus the bluegill could potentially trade with the grandmother on the other side of the board.
I wonder.
But Monsanto, again, taking his time. We saw him do this in the preliminary as well, and he says that he's not necessarily a particularly deliberate player, but in high-stakes situations like these, he wants to take the time he has available to him. If nothing else, just calm his, you know, ensure that he's able to keep focus and calm in the situation.
Yeah, in fact, I believe he says he doesn't really ever go to the rope in a lot of common ladder situations, but just needs to slow down because I think we've seen too many players get to this stage and rush to decision-making and, as a result, end up in awkward situations that are less than desirable because of it.
And this is a very nice turn for Monsanto here. He's able to clear off both of these minions and then play a Solemn Vigil for just one mana. So leaving just Kindly Grandmother up on the board, a single point of power for Hot Meowth, and Monsanto able to really get that card draw going.
That's right. And the way Hunter is built these days is really oriented on having the strong ability to keep stacking the power of the board. Houndmaster, and even just like the faster cards too that you do see in the deck, like Direwolf Alpha, the Argent Horse Rider that has yet to be revealed. And you know, all of these cards just end up making Hunter's pressure really strong so that by the time Call of the Wild comes in, it really is the closer as opposed to the starting pitcher, middle reliever, and the closer as Call of the Wild used to be prior to Karazhan.
Yeah, and Hot Meowth with a tracking here. Not the best options available. Kindly Grandmother gives him potentially some more board that is resilient to removal. Deadly Shot can help him against a potential Doomsayer on the other side of the board, which he has to be aware of.
Can he answer Doomsayer without the Deadly Shot?
He does have Quick Shot in his hand. He could take Kill Command to do essentially the same thing, assuming he's able to get some minion damage in. And speaking of minion damage, there is Huffer. Getting in four, so Monsanto down to 22. Still a relatively comfortable life total for this stage of the game against an aggressive Hunter deck.
Yeah, he also has that Forbidden Healing, Ragnaros Lightlord, and Ivory Knight to pick up more defensive options. So what? How does Monsanto want to deal with this? It's not very clean in terms of removal. He doesn't have Pyromancer to make it very easy. He also has that Barnes, which he could pick up something useful, although some of the best choices are already gone. For example, everyone always dreams about Barnes and Tyrion meeting together on the board on turn four.
It is glorious.
It is.
A tale of glorious redemption right there.
It is fantastic. Terrible tragedy, depending on who you ask.
Exactly.
I'm kind of feeling like Barnes might be better, because if you consecrate, you give up your consecration, you still leave three power on board, and you're still kind of stuck in this awkward situation. That's the power of Kindly Grandmother. You can't fully remove it very cleanly.
It is a difficult minion to deal with, in particular by AoE effects, because if you're able to just leave that on board, as Monsanto had been doing, I'm just going to let you keep this Grandmother on board. You just have this 1-1, not really that threatening. But when something else gets alongside it, it makes using things like Consecration quite awkward, as you saw right there.
Okay, so Monsanto chooses to play the Doomsayer, and this is going to buy him some time. Obviously, he's not very optimistic about Doomsayer's chances to survive the turn, but he can just use that to buy time and then hopefully pick up a better option. Also, force Hot Meowth and to be awkward with his cards. You're never too sure if you're overextending into a Pyromancer quality board.
Yeah, here, Hot Meowth has a great turn here, potentially killing the Doomsayer with just his minions on board. He could even play the Argent Horse Rider as well. The problem is that if he plays Argent Horse Rider, or even if he doesn't, and doesn't clear the 1-1 on the board, Consecration becomes so good next turn because he's already committed another minion. And now if he plays this and, goes face, now Monsanto has the ability to clear everything but that that Horse Rider from the board with his Consecration.
Yeah, it's fantastic for Monsanto as he's looking for a way to relieve pressure. Part of the ways that the Hunter wins is having this mid-game board be the main source of damage, constantly being supplemented by its hero power as well as direct damage like Kill Command. Not to mention also the threat of just the Savannah High Main coming down next turn as well. Monsanto has to be very careful about that.
Yeah, High Main is the big late game threat, other than Call of the Wild, though. Cottonmouth with only the burn spells really in his hand. And the Monsanto, he has really, really, really powerful cards once he actually gets to the late stage of the game. If he is able to survive until the point where he can coin 8 into 8, he has Tyrion, he has Ragnaros. Those match up very well against the late game cards that the Hunter deck has available to it.
Right, and he's got a good way to also bridge the gap, because you know part of the reasoning for some of those hunters, like, just try to kill him before he gets to that point. He has the Ivory Knight and Forbidden Healing once again to bridge himself until that point. Move quickly. So he chooses to pass here. Hot Meowth needs to pick up a strong minion.
That's a good one. The Infested Wolf gives him a sticky body in the board, and you know, if he hadn't picked up a minion there, or picked up something small, it would have really hurt his chances in this game. But now Monsanto.
Okay.
I expect we'll likely see that Ivory Knight come down, because it helps contest the board and can heal him a bit out of potential burst range. And he's only at 15 now, though, thanks to that hero power and attack last turn. So there is 5 on the board for Hot Meowth. He's actually nearly has lethal damage if Monsanto does not heal this turn.
Yeah, Monsanto has 15, or sorry, Hot Meowth has 15 damage, I believe, if you count everything with the hero power. There's 5 on board, mm-hmm. plus the kill, yeah. command, plus the quick shot hero power. And I believe the chances of scoring only 1 mana or 1 mana secrets for Discover is very
low.
It's something like people always talk about the secrets. It's like 6-7%. So it's like very unlikely that it ends up happening. That's the case.
I think something you mentioned, there's something like an 80% chance you get a 4 or more.
Yes. There's 28 spells in Paladin, I believe, that are currently in Standard.
Is he not going to heal? Monsanto looks like he maybe, if he plays Barnes here, I expect that
Forbidden Healing to come out too.
Yeah, maybe he won't. He's actually, oh. Wow. And Monsanto just plays the Barnes, and Hot Meowth has all the burn in the world that he needs to just finish the game off. So Monsanto trying to hold on there, wanted to look for maybe, I don't know, a Murloc there? I'm a little confused by that Barnes play. I don't really know what the idea behind that line of play was, but it cost Monsanto, and Hot Meowth takes a 2-0 lead.
Wow. I'm actually a little bit speechless about that.
Yeah, he could have found, for things that would immediately impact the board, there's Bluegill Warrior,
yeah.
There's Wild Pyromancer, and I think that's it.
Yeah, I think that's it. Everything else is either draw cards or just neutral.
Yeah.
Because he drew, like, Tyrion already by then. Very interesting, but didn't work out at all. Monsanto's down 0-2. Can he climb back? We'll find out right after you watch this little piece on him as we get ready for game number 3.
Right now, I play mostly combo decks.
What makes you like combo decks?
I like the way I have to think through every turn. Most pro players will advise new players to pick one deck, master it, and keep playing it until you play it perfectly. But I've done the exact opposite of that since I started playing. If you come into a championship or preliminaries only with ladder, it means you can master one, maybe two decks very well. In Conquest, it's not the best deck that matters, it's the worst deck that you have. So if you can play two decks perfectly and two other decks average, won't be as good as playing 4 decks above average.
Do you think taking your time and going all the way to the rope is crucial to success in Hearthstone?
I almost never do it, but in that tournament, I told myself that I would rope every single turn just to be sure to make the right plays. I think I'm gonna do it at championships too. It works, so.
To the America Summer Championship. You're in the middle of the series between Monsanto from Canada up against Hot Meowth from Nevada. Now, Hot Meowth is out 2-0 after what is a very interesting conclusion to game number 2. And I say that because I still don't know if I can figure it out.
I am, yeah, we've been sitting here trying to, you know, debate what you know, what the plan was that Monsanto had. Because, you know, he clearly had something in mind that he was going for when he played the Barnes there. Mm-hmm. And really, you know, we're looking at the list, and the two cards he could have hit with Barnes that would have had an immediate impact due to Ragnaros and Tyrion in his hand were Bluegill Warrior and Wild Pyromancer.
Right.
If he had Bluegill Warrior, he can just trade into the 2-1. Mm-hmm. And obviously, getting an extra Bluegill Warrior can be very important later in the game.
Yeah, he had anything in hand.
Already, yeah. Mm-hmm. If he gets Wild Pyromancer, he can play the coin and then Forbidden Healing himself, which also kills the 2-1.
Right.
Or just play the coin, or just play Forbidden Healing. Right. Either one is available.
Limited,
to play.
Right. Though, still.
But yeah, but that only clears the 2-1 from the board.
Mm-hmm. Versus so, you heal for the you most likely would heal for the equivalent of that 2 damage.
Right.
And also develop a 4-4 on board.
So it was a very, very strange play to me, and I'm really not sure what Monsanto was doing there.
Yeah, not to mention there was also a lot of, like, minions that wouldn't do anything. Peacekeeper being one of them, another Ivory Knight, a 1-1 Doomsayer, which would have been completely inconsequential. So we're trying to tap into the mindset, but, I mean, that's just the games in the past. Monsanto's going to have to revisit that Paladin deck if he wants to get back into the series. For now, he's going to turn to what is his current favorite deck, which is the Worgen Warrior. This deck is quickly become one of the most difficult decks to pilot in Hearthstone. I've definitely stayed away from this deck because I myself have a hard time piloting it. But I always am fascinated when players like Oskaka and now Monsanto.
I prefer to play decks that can be described as fun and interactive, so I've also steered clear
of this. Oh, really? Or are you a big fan of our Lord and Savior? Yaxxaran and his mistress, Elise Starseeker, and the Golden Monkey.
Oh, they are, you know, bow down. That is appropriate. But players are looking to play the Druid versus the Warrior. And this is a matchup that typically tends to lean in the favor, in my experience, very much of the Warrior. Mm-hmm. Because the plan that of just sort of cycling through your deck and blowing your opponent up, it tends to be pretty good against the plan of the Druid. Now, this is the Malygos version of Druid, which is a bit better against the Warrior deck than the token versions, because it's not vulnerable to the Wild Pyromancer plan, the Ravaging Ghouls and such, and it does have its own sort of explosive end game as well. It also has a little bit more play, this version, that, given the fact that it has 2 copies of Feral Rage. Being able to increase your health outside of the general range that the burst damage of the Warrior deck can do does have a pretty big impact on the Warrior deck's ability to combo kill you.
Do you have an opinion on the inclusion of cards like Gadgetzan Auctioneer and Moonglade Portal into the Malygos lists?
I've liked the Auctioneer and the Moonglade Portal quite a bit, actually. I've been playing a little bit with the Malygos version. In fact, an exact list that Hot Meowth is playing, which was played by, I believe, Muzzy and also Zyxo, two very high legend. I believe Muzzy got number 1 with it recently. And the Gadgetzan Auctioneer allows the deck to have the ability to just dig super, super deep into the deck. You know, when you have Auctioneer and Raven Idol, it almost doesn't seem fair. In fact, it kind of isn't fair. But
yeah, I believe Muzzy and his teammate Frozen were the ones really, you know, pioneering the deck originally. I think Frozen was the one climbing with it in the very beginnings. And you know, like, Auctioneer has been a very interesting card in this, because there's a lot of cheap cards that obviously work really well, Innervate being one of them, Living Roots, Moonfire. However, I think people have sort of fallen off the dependence on Malygos. Whenever you see a Malygos deck, it feels like it's so critical to its strategy, but it's just one of the many threats that are in the Druid deck. You still have Arcane Giants, you still have the ability to just power onto the board. You still have Yogg-Saron as one of those options too. So it's a very, very potent deck. In my opinion, it's one of the strongest decks currently in the game, but people are still figuring out how to play it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Monsanto going to go ahead and get his card drawn going with Inner Rage on an Acolyte of Pain. Hot Meowth, he has many of the key cards for this matchup in his hand. He has the 2 copies of Feral Rage, as well as, you know, a lot of ramp of his own. Going to go ahead and innervate out Fandral into a Living Roots to take down the Acolyte, giving himself A bit of a board already and slowing down the card draw Monsanto has available.
Yeah, this has been very smart by Hot Meowth. He recognizes that he saved Innervate and the coin, so that way he can coin out the Nourish next turn and really explode at the gate. Monsanto, of course, not going to let that happen. And by picking up Fiery War Axe, he's now found a way to get his Battle Rage enabled by damaging himself, too, because that was something of concern.
Yeah, in a lot of instances with Warrior versus Druid, you might look to just play, say, Blood to Ichor, War Axe here to kill the Fandral and build yourself a bit of a board. With the Worgen Warrior, though, your Blood to Ichors are often pretty important with your Pyromancer Commanding Shout Battle Rage combo because right. It gives you the ability to have a cheap spell that can help enable the Pyromancer and a body for the Battle Rage. So Monsanto is kind of deep in figuring out exactly what he wants to do. He is just going to go ahead and fire those off, though, so he will have a little bit less power on his Battle Rages later on. Decides to just go for the immediate board presence here and to get the Fend off the board without using his Execute.
Perhaps he's hoping to just get Battle Rage for two. He does have ways to dig also with the shield block. It's not as if the Blood to Ichor. Well, the one thing I am hesitant about is that the Blood Taker was a great enabler for Execute, but he doesn't have to worry about things like the Arcane Giants for some time. Okay,
right.
Now Hot Meowth can double trade and make sure to take off one of these 2-1 or 2-2s. Excuse me.
Yeah, and this ensures that Monsanto again, you know, has at best the Battle Rage for one next turn unless he's able to damage his own minion. And Hot Meowth now probably not going to Moonfire anything.
Yeah, he's got four spells in hand, so the cheapest he can make his Giants is four mana over the course of two turns. Or three turns, excuse me. So that's still a while away. And Hot Meows, I mean, I feel like Arcane Giants just come in pairs. It's two by two. They never really come alone.
They ride to hide their numbers, you know.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Single file.
I thought it was just some kind of ride together, die together.
That could be a two.
Shield block just to start digging into the deck. You're going to look for Monsanto's, of course, going to look for pieces. His Worgen, Raging Worgen, Charges ready in hand, Rampage being another, Face Manipulator also being a piece. And one thing that I also love about the Worgen Warrior is that a lot of times you just have to keep pivoting your strategies based off the order of which you drawn things. Sometimes you see people use Faceless Manipulator for things that don't exactly make the most sense on paper.
Yeah, we saw Monsanto really take a number of interesting lines of play with the Worgen Warrior deck during the preliminary. Mm-hmm. He's playing a version of the deck that is a little bit unusual. The most common version of the deck typically has only one copy of Worgen, one copy of Charge, and a copy of Rampage. He's playing the double Worgen, double Charge version, which allows him to be a little bit more liberal with those two cards. And we saw him use I think it was Commanding Shout Worgen Charge to kill minions in the board, and then kill his opponent with a Faceless Manipulator on his Draconid Crusher. And
yeah.
Lots of cool stuff going on.
Yeah, really scrappy game, and that's kind of what Monsanto really likes. He felt like too many times Warriors are just stuck holding the combo pieces in anticipation, and obviously the opponent knows that and plays around the specific numbers. Hot Meowth with the Raven Idol just chooses to ramp and pick up Starfire, perhaps just get a clean removal on Emperor Thorsand, doesn't have to commit too many resources to it. Wrath didn't exactly look that appealing, I guess.
And now Monsanto picks up the second Execute. So those Giants have tools waiting in the wings to take care of them. But Monsanto still needs to get a lot deeper in his deck here. Hot Meowth has had an excellent opening and been able to dig pretty deep and ramp a bit. So he's able to really get to his explosive turns pretty soon. And Monsanto is actually pretty far from being able to do the same.
Well, he can start things off with Slam, start digging into his deck. Ravaging Ghoul, not the most useful here.
And Ravaging Ghoul can potentially enable his Battle Rage in a future turn, and the second copy of Charge, certainly not what he's looking for.
Yeah, definitely not. Monsanto probably just going to end up passing here after he just hero powers. Hot Meowth, still, he can finally start putting Giant Pressure out, but it's still going to take up most of his turn. He can Living Roots and then play the Arcane Giant to make sure that there's no easy enabler. Like, at least he has to commit his armor.
Mm-hmm. It also prevents Monsanto from having the exact play that he does have, which is Ravaging Ghoul plus Execute plus Battle Rage for the additional card if the 2-2 is still in play. So Hot Meowth gets the Giant down, and while Monsanto has the answer, he's not able to leverage the same advantage he might be able to get if that that Slime were still in play.
Yep, so the only Execute enabler he has besides his Fiery War Axe just attacking the Giant straight up is the Ravaging Ghoul here. Ravaging Ghoul Execute leaves you 4 mana, so I guess you can also start digging through your deck. How useful is it to hold on to the Commanding Shout versus cycling it? Doesn't seem very powerful.
He really needs to find more tools. Monsanto here, he doesn't have access to a Wild Pyromancer just yet. So the Commanding Shout, not really capable of doing that much. And this is also not really the token version of Druid, as we mentioned earlier.
That's true.
Against the token version of Druid, where this Warrior deck really shines, the Pyromancer plus Commanding Shout combo is really important for clearing off their board. Hot Meowth isn't really looking to build a board of small minions. He's going to play these big giants and not much else.
Do you think it's okay just to take the damage from the giant as well? Because like, you do have 34 health, and you know what about, was there merit to just playing Shield Block and then maybe waiting for Ravaging Ghoul to have a more opportune moment?
I think
you picked up Acolyte.
Yeah, I think that Monsanto is in a position where he needs to assemble more resources, and significantly more resources, because his hand is just super awkward here with just the charges. He doesn't have his enablers, he doesn't have Emperor, he doesn't have Worgen. He just has combo pieces, but not the right ones in the right combination. Mm-hmm. And in order to find those, he needs to be battle raging. He needs to be picking up additional cards. And by not saving the Ravaging Ghoul, if he does draw another minion, unless that minion is basically exactly Wild Pyromancer, he isn't really able to do that.
Yeah, I would have liked to see Monsanto to be able to try to posh himself to dig through the deck, but I do recognize that taking 8 damage per turn isn't exactly a very pleasant option either.
Well, he's also playing against the Malygos version, which has pretty significant burst potential, and Hot Meowth, he has developed a fairly big hand here. And he's going to go ahead and swipe that off and just innervate into... It looks like he's going to go ahead and Feral Rage for armor and then play his Giant. So able to develop a nice buffer against the Burst combo and get down to 8-8. There's a Worgen, but Monsanto still very far off from being able to do any sort of explosive damage. Doesn't have the Faceless either. Another Commanding Shout again, not what he's looking for.
Yeah, but I think at this point you're still just looking for some way to enable that Worgen with Charge, Raging Worgen, and Inner Rage. That is 6-8. That's 16 damage plus the 3 damage weapons, so that's 19. Still a far cry from the 33, but you'd be closer to potentially killing your opponent if you pick up that Faceless Manipulator. But then you have to start the question: do you have enough mana to do all that? So you probably need to play the Emperor Thor's Hand and dig to that as well.
Yeah, Monsanto does still have his War Axe here. He could just attack into this, eat the 8 damage, and then execute the Giant. There's not that many, but he does find Slam, okay. So he's not going to have to take the 8. He will just Slam and execute here. Finds the Faceless. So he's getting to the point that he nearly has the full combo. Does not have the cost reduction from Emperor, though. And then Starfire to the face.
Why not?
Yeah. I absolutely like that decision from Hot Meowth. Just digging for more resources here and further padding his life total up to 41. And that's pretty much out of range of the one-turn damage capabilities. And Monsanto, he's like, all right, well, if that's how it's going to be. And this is one of the strengths of the double charge, double Worgen version.
Right.
He's able to just get this 12 damage in here and say, okay, now you actually have to deal with this, and I can still come back again and combo you.
Well, there is one way to deal with it. Yogg-Saron comes down, and his goal is just one thing. Well, two things, really. Clear the board and try to draw as many cards as possible.
Lightning Storm is big.
Lightning Storm guaranteed to kill the Worgen. Little bit off. Oh man, that's always iffy. Drawing cards, though, is pretty powerful. Farsight could also be really nasty if he gets Malygos. Oh man. More card draw. That's 6 cards being drawn this turn.
Yeah, that was a pretty powerful Yogg-Saron from Hot Meowth here. I mean, he was already in a pretty strong position, but definitely helps solidify the advantage that he has now. Suddenly, an old god on the board, and that secret could be problematic too. I didn't actually quite catch which secret that was. One thing that's really problematic for the Worgen combo deck is Freezing Trap.
Freezing Trap is disastrous. Also in the cases where Worgen's too weak to take a hit from the explosive trap as well, because he doesn't have Rampage. So it's like one of these things where a lot of possibilities could really mess it up. Emperor Thor isn't not a bad card.
Oh, and there's a secret revealed. Man. It is Snipe.
That's also a bad one, too, for the Raging Worgen.
Could have been real bad for Worgen, but Emperor takes one for the team and stays alive.
Yeah. So if he picks up an Inner Rage, well played. Monsanto just tossing out the well played. I guess maybe he's not feeling very optimistic about his chances here.
Could be a rough one for him. Hotmail does have a pretty big hand here. And Hotmail's got to be, you know, got to be worried here.
Right.
You know, what is the possibility that Monsanto just has the tools he needs to end the game next turn?
Well, if he picks up the Inner Rage, that would be lethal, right?
Yeah.
Because he has the Faceless Charge as well. So it's in Hot Meowth's best interest to just play defensive while putting as much pressure as possible.
So Hot Meowth, what he chose to Raven Idol for a minion here. I expect looking for a taunt.
Taunt, yeah.
Because he knows that.
What? Did you ask for a taunt?
I said taunt and look what happened.
Did you ask for a taunt? Brian, you have a gift.
Oh, dear. What have I done? Monsanto, I'm sorry, I just said taunt.
I'll tell you the same thing that my Uncle Ben told me. With great power comes great responsibility.
Well, there was no Inner Rage waiting for Monsanto anyway. He's in a world of hurt here. Not really able to get past that Sunwalker. I mean, he doesn't have the tools left in his deck even. Both executes are gone. And yeah, Monsanto recognized that. He's going to go ahead and concede. Hot Meowth is up 3-0 in this series.
This has been a stomp. But once again, I do have to feel like Monsanto could have definitely taken a little bit of a different approach into how he drew through his deck. That is one of the key components to making sure that you can play consistent to your strategy. And now he's found himself down in a 0-3 hole. Winning 4 games in a row is a tall task indeed. Meowth feeling pretty good about himself. Let's get to know him a little bit more as we get ready for game number 4 and see whether or not he can close it out in a 4-0 sweep.
Do you have any hobbies, anything that you like to do outside of Hearthstone and school?
Well, I like playing guitar, and I like to listen to a lot of bad music. I guess you can say I'm a kind of emo because like I listen to a lot of emotional music too. But I just like playing guitar, playing rock songs or acoustic songs, like jam it out, using mixing softwares, like audio softwares, to mix it with drums and bass and try to make like different soundtracks. And sometimes I try to sing, even though I'm not really good at it. But I really like feedback, whether it's Hearthstone or music. I really like feedback to know like where are my mistakes and how can I like make it sound better or how do I make that play better.
So let's say you're at the championship, okay? And you win the whole thing. And you go up here, you're rewarded with your trophy, and then Froden walks onto the stage with a guitar and tells you to play. What song do you play?
I play Wonderwall, so maybe I can get some girls to like me, and I can get like a good relationship. Hook me up with some like cute girls to like hang out with.
Hang out and play Hearthstone with?
Yeah.
Froden would be the best wingman in that situation.
Welcome back, everybody, to America's Summer Championship. It's currently 3-0 in the score of that eligible bachelor that you see right there, ready to serenade your hearts with Wonderwall by Oasis. That's right. 15 years later, we're still doing it. It hasn't gone away.
It's been a long time.
Yeah.
It's been a long time.
Monsanto, he's down 0-3, and his combo deck lineup is not faring very well. What's the diagnosis, Dr. Kibler?
Well, this is exactly the matchup that he thought this match would hinge on, is against the Warlock deck from Hot Meowth. He feels like all of his decks are very strong in this matchup, and it's going to be put to the test.
So he has to win every single game up against the Zoo Warlock, which he was targeting from the beginning. And Hot Meowth, of course, knew that, tried to play keep away, but no longer can he avoid any of the matchups. So Monsanto's going to start things off with the Warrior once again. Now, Hot Meowth, we do notice some interesting card choices here. It's not the first time we've seen cards like Demon Fire, Lance Carrier, Argent Horse Rider make an appearance in Zoo, but it's certainly very unorthodox.
Yeah, the introduction of Malkazar's Imp has not only allowed the Warlock Zoo decks to play more of a discard-centric strategy, but also a demon-centric strategy. You have the full number of Voidwalkers and Imps of both the Flame and Malkazar variety that you can play on turn one and just Demon Fire on turn two to just get in there for more damage.
Yeah, people already are well aware of how strong, and people were so afraid of Mark of Yashiraj going onto the Raven, the Enchanted Raven, all of a sudden the 4/4 mana. Demon Fire functions very similarly while giving you flexibility, and you don't really have to worry too much about card draw source because, you know, the Imp synergizes with card draw as well as your life tap.
And here Monsanto chose to hold his War Axe. He could have coined out War Axe, which would have prevented the Demon Fire on turn two, but instead he chose to hold on to his coin, obviously a very powerful card with Wild Pyromancer in his hand, but he's kind of immediately punished here by the Demon Fire buffing up that Imp and preventing any removal this turn.
Yeah, that ended up being really harsh. That's probably the card that punished him the most. I think a lot of Warriors also keep in mind a Voidwalker in the back of their heads, but, you know, Monsanto just, now he has to get through this the hard way. If he starts to slam it or fire War Axes over two turns, it's going to be painful either way.
Absolutely, and building up the health of that demon makes all of Monsanto's non-execute removal a lot less effective. And if he's forced to use mana and resources over two turns dealing with this, it puts him in a worse position to deal with Hot Meowth's follow-up as well. You know, Hot Meowth has the Imp Gang boss next turn, and if Monsanto has to use, say, double War Axe swings or slam plus War Axe, that leaves him with less tools to deal with the rest of what's going on.
Okay, chooses to attack. Now, I believe with the Wild Pyromancer next turn and the slam and the coin that he should be able to deal with all of this. And that's kind of like the really difficulty of where Zoo finds itself in this matchup, is that despite everything, the Warrior can still be able to withstand its pressure, even if it's at low health.
Yep, Monsanto does have the ability to Pyromancer and then coin, which will deal one to everything. Then play Slam, which will deal two to the Imp Gang boss. Obviously, each of these points of damage to the Imp Gang boss trigger it, but the Pyromancer will clear out more of what's going on. So, certainly, despite the start from Hot Meowth, Monsanto's deck is full of answers.
Yeah, I'm trying to see if there's an alternative that's even cleaner that allows him to perhaps even keep the Pyromancer on board. That's really powerful if you sequence it, but I don't think there is one.
He could use his War Axe. He could attack the Imp Gang with his War Axe, then Pyromancer coin Commanding Shout.
Oh, you're right. There is a Commanding Shout in the hand. I was only focused on the slam.
Yeah, so this allows him to actually keep the Pyromancer on the board. He does lose the War Axe, but this leaves him in a position where he's able to potentially slam with Pyromancer on board next turn and still draw the card from the Commanding Shout as well.
Yeah, this is much better. I was so focused on the slam plays, just trying to be crafty. Like, maybe you don't draw a card, but this is what the Commanding Shout's function is supposed to do. Make sure that you can clear the board. And from this position, Hot Meowth's game plan is pretty straightforward. Just try to put as much pressure onto the board.
I mean, speaking of pressure, Monsanto, he's at 19. This is turn three. He's at 19 life.
Yeah, but realistically, we know that 19 might as well be 30 if you can't really end the game as the Zoo Warlock. Although you do run some chargers here. You have the Horse Rider, you have the Doom Guard, so it's not out of the world of possibility that you push your opponent for damage.
I'm actually a little surprised that Hot Meowth chose to play the Lance Carrier this turn rather than life tapping. He has to expect that the Imp is potentially likely to get removed by, say a Blood to Ichor, even just with the trigger from the Pyromancer.
Right.
So I'm a little bit surprised to see that particular decision from Hot Meowth here, considering he is low on resources in hand. He could have life tapped and dug himself a little bit deeper. It does not really give him a good turn the following turn. Maybe he's just hoping that Monsanto doesn't have access to a Blood to Ichor or something of the sort.
Yeah, and what does that amount of pressure really amount to? It's hard to say. Monsanto choosing to play the Accolade here first. I was thinking about the Raging Worgen as a way to play defensive, but doesn't feel that threatened by just having two power on the board from his opponent.
I like the Accolade here because it can dig him to more of his tools, even something like an Inner Rage here if he wanted to go. Actually, it doesn't give him the Pyromancer. That doesn't really do anything. But
yeah, unfortunately.
And yeah, he's going to go ahead and use that Dark Iron Dwarf to clear off the Accolade, I'm sure, and then probably remove the slime as well. Debating whether he wants to actually just get the 3 damage in there. It is crucial to get the potential damage. Does decide to Soulfire to save 1 damage on his Voidwalker. This makes his board better against the Ravaging Ghoul or another Wild Pyromancer activation, but leaves him without a little bit of the burst damage that could help finish the game.
I believe it. I mean, the way you can kind of equate it is if Voidwalker can attack 2 more times, then it's worth more damage than the Soulfire.
Well, it's also, the Voidwalker was dealing 3 there as well. So if he did decide to attack it, he would be missing that damage to the face as well.
Right. So Monsanto does have ways he could deal with the board. He's got the Raging, well, he's not the Raging, but the Ravaging Ghoul. He's got Slam. He's got the Execute if he wants to deal with that as well. I think just putting powerful plays on the board now that your opponent is life tapping and falling further behind is also valuable too. If you're able to secure the board, even just having Raging Worgen without it being contested can also pressure your opponent's life total as well, which is very good.
Well, I was even going to go ahead and Inner Rage, taking out the Voidwalker, so leaving Hot Meowth with absolutely nothing in play, down to the top of his deck and his life tap ability. What will he find? As a Demon Fire, doesn't work too well with Argent Squire.
Yeah, one of the drawbacks, of course, is this very situation where Demon Fire doesn't really remove, doesn't really do anything. And Monsanto can start climbing back onto the board very ferociously here. Can start also drawing cards, which is important.
He actually also just picked up Inner Rage. He has now Worgen Charge plus Inner Rage, which represents a pretty significant amount of burst damage. Also Battle Rage, so now going to be able to pick up some more cards. And this is really just climbing out of reach. Despite Hot Meowth's excellent opening, Monsanto showing exactly why he feels his lineup in this deck in particular is so favored against the Warlock deck.
And I believe if Monsanto already used one Inner Rage, right? So he can't draw lethal next turn. He's just a little bit off. In the meantime, Hot Meowth picks up Voidwalker to stem some of the bleeding. So the Demon Fire plus the Voidwalker means that everything is shut off from the board temporarily, but Monsanto's still got a lot more where that came from. Now you can start to understand why that, this matchup just seems to be very polarized in the Warriors' favor.
I mean, he can even just clear the board again with Ravaging Ghoul. And in this instance, he has Accolade of Pain. He can draw more cards with it. And he is playing against this non-Forbidden Ritual version of the Warlock deck. So he can use his AoE effects kind of with impunity. He doesn't need to save them.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much lethal for Monsanto next turn, because he's got 16 from the Worgen and then 3 from the Fiery War Axe. Oh, I apologize. He has Doomguard. I don't know. The damage from the Famine is enough, though. So it looks like Monsanto is just going to wrap this up very systematically. Not even really that close, despite it being a very fast start for the Zoo Warlock. How about that?
Yeah, we just saw just how powerful that Pyromancer was able to be, clearing off so much of the board. And all the tools that the combo deck can use, either to kill your minions or just kill you in this particular instance.
Yeah, not the most terribly exciting conclusion to it, because it felt like it was going one way. But if there's anything that's to show you guys, just how good it is at dissecting some of those tempo board oriented decks like Zoo in the very early games. And Monsanto is able to at least get one win on the board. No one wants to come all the way over here just to lose 4-0. So with that, we're going to show you guys a quick piece and then come back for game number 5 very shortly.
So tell me how you got into Hearthstone.
Friends of mine showed me the game. It was my first card game that I ever played, so I lost my 17 first games. And I kept playing. I liked it, though. I wasn't going to be competitive at first. I played Arena, I played on Ladder.
Where did it sort of change to where you're thinking to yourself, I think I could start playing this game competitively?
I think it's the first time I hit Legend. I kept playing more and more, and I hit Legend every season. I watched a lot of streams. I learned there were online cups, and from there I played every week. That's where it started.
Everybody to the America Summer Championship. 3-1 is the current count as Hot Meow is still looking to close out the series in any way possible. For now, we still have Monsanto's choice of his Druid deck, his Paladin deck, which he did play in the first two games, or he could just change it up as well. Now, Hot Meow with his Zoo Warlock deck, that is a deck that is interestingly enough going through sort of a weird identity crisis.
Yeah, Hot Meow actually said that this was the list of his that he was the least confident in, because you know, it's a new version of Zoo. He wasn't sure if this particular list was sufficiently tuned to really justify its inclusion in his lineup compared to sort of more traditional styles of Zoo. But it certainly is capable of some very powerful things, as we saw in the last game, but in that matchup just wasn't quite enough. And this is another matchup that is very difficult for the Zoo deck to win.
Yeah, it's definitely better than normal because you're not stuck with Power Overwhelmings in the hand. You do have more direct damage from the hand, too, with Soulfire, the Argent Horse Riders. So you have a little bit more tools, but it's still extremely difficult because of the way that the board just constantly gets stalled by the freezes, and you can't really kill them fast enough. Monsanto is the one who's bringing the interesting variant of Freeze Mage, in my opinion. Freeze Mage also going through a period of uncertainty as they're trying to figure out what's the best 30 cards. They usually have 26 down, but the question is, do I put in Flame Strikes? You know, how does cards like Medivh's Valet fit in, if at all, which it doesn't really, spoiler. You know, people were theory crafting if Curator can guarantee draw you Alexstrasza. Mm-hmm. I think the card that's been surprising people, though, is the Evolved Kobold.
Yep.
People have been putting that in some of the Freeze Mage lists, trying to burst down their opponents bit faster.
One of the big things with the Evolved Kobold is that it gives you additional burst potential against opponents who are able to armor up. This has become particularly important because of the rise of the Malygos Druid decks, including two copies of Feral Rage. Your ability to burn through that without additional spell damage is quite limited, but the Evolved Kobold gives you extra burst. What you need here, though, is not extra burst. You need to keep yourself alive.
Yeah, very interesting, too, because I know Monsanto has all, the most important thing is that Freeze Mages also tend to practice together. They congregate like a flock of birds. They all go, Laughing Senpai, please show me your ways. And, you know, interestingly enough, Laughing did help coach some of these players who are here in the Americas. He talked to Dude for a while and helped Dude prepare. And now Monsanto playing the Kobold list that Laughing was posting as well.
Is there like a secret lair somewhere of like the Fraternal Order of Freeze Mages or something? We heard, you know, last season, you're either a Freeze Mage or you're not. I don't know if I wouldn't be invited to their parties, but
yeah, Einar, of course, was the one quote on saying that, which I mistakenly said Dr. Hippie did. but I always appreciate a very good Freeze Mage player, as you know, they're far and few in between these days. It seems like a lot of them just don't have faith when you have aggressive shaman builds. When you have, you know, the warrior still being very strong, it's difficult being a Freeze Mage out there.
So it's interesting. We've actually seen in both the Americas and Europe preliminaries a disproportionate number of players who included Freeze Mage in their lineups made the top 8.
It's true.
You know, we see here Monsanto, Dude, and Pascoa all playing Freeze Mage.
I do want to ask, Kibler, is it because of Freeze Mage, or is it because the people who tend to like playing Freeze Mage and bring them in tournaments also tend to be some of our better players?
I think that it's probably a combination of those things. I do think that strong players tend to gravitate toward decks with lots of decisions, and clearly Freeze Mage is one of those. But I do think that, particularly in the metagame that existed during the summer preliminary, the popularity of exactly this deck, Zoo, caused Freeze Mage deck to overperform relative to the field.
I do like to observe as well that nobody who qualified brought a Shadow Form Dragon Priest.
I didn't even play, okay?
You tell me who's a rear winner and loser.
And I never play Shadow Form Dragon Priest. I play Shadow Form or Dragon Priest, you know?
Well, maybe that's your issue.
You gotta get them both together.
I'm just feeding you ideas for your stream at this point. Monsanto, he's, you know, trying to see if he can bide his time. I think, you know, drawing with a novice engineer is not bad. Or, I guess, draw first with loot hoarders to see if it changes your play at all. Being mana efficient is really important. Digging through your deck is also really important because there are ways for your opponent to answer your Doomsayer. You know, there is that world of that double Soulfire, for example, or the Dark Peddler drew some extra damage. In this case, it is Power Overwhelming. So you have to be, you always have to be plotting something as a backup plan as a Freeze Mage. You can't always just assume Frost Nova, Doomsayer, and 5 works.
It is usually reliable, though, you know, Hot Mouth does have, as you mentioned, that Power Overwhelming. And if he gets to 6 mana, he could have the Power Overwhelming plus Lance Carrier to, or the dog there, the Direwolf Alpha, to burst it down. But it is just going to be a bunch of damage to the face here. Is he leaving up the...
I think he should kill a 1-1.
It seems like that is preferable here.
Yeah, primarily because your opponent will start doing like fancy stuff of like attacking in-game boss and freezing your board. You will have one more spot open because the Voidwalker does die. But also maybe just the threat of spell power too for Blood Mage down. No, sometimes, like a lot of times in this matchup too specifically, Freeze Mage doesn't actually have to burn their opponent that much because the Life Tap naturally drains their life, so does Flame Imp. And it ends up, it's almost as if freezing the board and removing the minions is dealing direct damage because they keep Life Tapping.
This is actually going to be huge. Hot Meowth has the Argent Horse Rider plus Power Overwhelming, which he can put next to the dog.
Yeah, you're right. Oh, man.
So this is... That's Monsanto massive. Has Frost Nova Doomsayer, but Hot Meowth has the absolute perfect answer in his hand.
Yeah. There is a follow-up Blizzard, so it's not as if Monsanto would get blown out. But now there's like more than a chance, you know? It's not... Before, you kind of feel like a lot of this is inevitable. Like, oh, Zeus going to try, just like Freeze Mage tries to overcome the armor count. But the moment Jessica Trueheart gets played, you know, Freeze Mage kind of taps out. It almost feels similar when the Mage is able to get out Emperor Thorsen on a clean board and Zeus can't really answer it.
Yeah. As you mentioned, Monsanto does have the Blizzard here if he wants to take care of most of this board. There is that Imp Gang boss, which is buffed up by a Lance Carrier, so is more of a threat than it would normally be.
So, also, there's the contingency plan of trying to burn your opponent. Evolve Cobalt plus Frostbolt Ice Lance, because you can't fit the Fireball in as well. There's a pretty good chunk of damage, so he has to start counting if there's a possible way to like see if his opponent life taps when he blizzards. Does he start playing his secrets instead as well over the next couple of turns after he blizzards? This is all going through his mind.
Yeah, and the Monsanto deciding whether he wants to attack the face, maybe he attacks into a minion here.
I mean, going face is a pretty legitimate option because of the way his hand is lining up with the Evolve Cobalt and the Frostbolt Ice Lance.
Yeah, it's capable of doing a lot of burst damage. Yeah. And, you know, Hot Meowth does not have that big of a board right now. Mm-hmm. Is going to expand a little bit more. Oh, the Defender of Argus will keep that that Imp Gang as a legitimate threat.
Yeah, I need to check the list. So it seems that Monsanto actually does have cut Flame Strike, which does make Zoo matchups a little bit more awkward. But Flame Strike has always been in and out based off just the interpretation of if you really need it in the metagame, because the freeze is more important oftentimes than the Flame Strike. Like, Blizzard just buys you the turns, and Flame Strike is powerful to clear the board in instances where there's a lot of mid-range minions that do fit the bill. But with these days, the boards tend to be all over the place. Sometimes they get really strong, sometimes you have one string of strong minion, like the Flame Wreath Faceless. So they do tend to cut it. Monsanto here now is also in a position where he can start drawing cards again, and that might line up more cleanly with his burn plan.
Yeah, it looks like he is going to do exactly that. Play the Acolyte, ping it. He will find what's in the box. It's an Arcane Intellect, so more card draw. I'm curious to see if he decides to use this Frostbolt to take out the Imp Gang. It does represent 5 damage. And yeah, he does decide to go a little bit more on the removal plan. Will need to find another enabler for that Ice Lance before he can switch to that burn strategy now.
Right. It's like we were talking about, if you kill the minions, it almost as if you're burning your opponent directly in this matchup specifically. But Monsanto... Oh, okay, he picked up second Frostbolt. So I was like, but the thing is, you know, he needs a little bit more burn than what he has right there, because he does give up his enabler for Ice Lance. That is a lot of damage coming in.
Yeah, this is quite a bit of damage. And what's interesting about Hot Meowth's particular build, the Lance Carriers and the Demon Wraths, or rather the Demon Fires, give him the ability to create larger minions that stick around. We saw how much bigger a threat that Imp Gang boss was, and now this Imp is a pretty big threat. It's a 4-4 that's sticking around.
Okay, so his opponent has 8, 10, 12 damage next turn. Monsanto looking to survive here. He might have to part ways with Fireball and then play Ice Block. Perhaps he's Forgotten Torch if he feels like if he wants to play Arcane Intellect as well this turn. He could Arcane Intellect to draw cards if he feels safe enough. Forgotten Torch to kill off the 4-4 and then use his hero power. I do like the prospect of like your opponent just keeps life tapping and you kind of keep the range to burn your opponent because you have Ice Block. So you can play Evolve Cobalt, Frostbolt, Ice Lance one turn and then save Fireball for the following turn.
Looks like he is going to go ahead and... Oh, he's going to Torch. Oh, he wants to Torch first.
Good sequence.
He wants to give himself a better chance of drawing Torch. So, while some people may be screaming, draw last, draw last. He's actually doing this for a reason. He wants to draw that Roaring Torch.
Right, right. That's something that I wasn't accounting for when I was looking at the Arcane Intellect play. And very sharp, as astute observation from Monsanto. You are not the boss
of me. And now, you know, the attacks from Hot Meowth getting Monsanto down to just 9 life. And the debate over whether he wants to commit this Flame Imp will decide to play it.
Oh, man. You did just see your opponent Frost, Forgotten Torch, and then draw.
Yeah, how much damage does Monsanto have available now? The second Ice Lance is pretty huge because it represents a huge amount of damage. 6, including the damage from the Evolved Kobold here.
17 with the full... Oh, sorry, I was counting just the Wolf Kobold. Is the Fireball just better? It's the same damage, because Fireball is the 6.
Well, he can do it over turns here. He could actually Frost Nova now, and then Fireball Ping. And then I believe he just has lethal damage with Evolved Kobold next turn, right?
Should be the case. Assuming that Hot Meowth doesn't have anything that would surprise us otherwise.
Yeah, Hot Meowth would have to have some way to do 9 points of burst from his hand, which isn't really... He could... Draw a
Doomguard
and then life tap into Soulfire.
Yeah, better just be safer by
obviously you can Ice Block instead of using the Frost Nova. Yeah. So both of them do the same thing, except what is better in this instance?
3, 7, 8, 12. So he's got enough to damage right here to pop the Ice Block, but that should do it here. Like, there's just no way for the Zoo Warlock to push past that Ice Block.
Yep, Ice Block is popped, but...
I'm waiting for the time where there's a one-mana thing that can interact with Secrets and Dark Peddler becomes the out. But Evolve Kobold gets the flashy exit, and that is quite a amount of damage there. Just to get to put on display why the Evolve Kobold was considered from first place. So even if his opponent was at 18 health, be able to burst it down pretty fast. And Monsanto is going to go... 2 wins into the series now, so the score is 3-2.
And just as the players predicted, the Zoo deck is really the linchpin of this matchup. We saw Hot Meowth get pretty quick victories with everything else, but now he's kind of struggling to find one with the Zoo.
Yep, still a couple of games left to go if Monsanto wants to complete the reverse sweep. In the meantime, we got a chance to sit down with Hot Meowth, talk to him about his play style and everything about. So take a look as we get ready for game number 6.
Do you think it's better to bring the best decks, or is it better to bring decks that you're more comfortable with?
From my experience, probably bring the decks that you're more comfortable with. For me, I'll have stress when I'm playing on stream, or like playing in like tournaments at a higher level. And when I get stressed out, like I'll tend to misplay more. So you kind of want to like play something you're comfortable with that you think you're not going to misplay. So you can always make the optimal play and like run from there on. I think you'll have more success with that instead of just bringing the best decks. But I like bringing the best decks if that's what I like to play.
Welcome back, everybody, to the America Summer Championship. It's Frodan and Brian Kibler bringing you guys the second series of the day. The winner moves on. The loser stays in his hotel room for 2 more awkward days. And
so
has to watch the broadcast or maybe ignore it. In this single elimination, best of 7, Monsanto's had to deal with the pressure of being down 0-3. And now he is getting closer to tying it up, 3-2.
Yes, about as good of a spot as you can be in, having started 0-3. But Monsanto battling back against Hot Meowth Zudeck. And as we've said many times, this was exactly the deck that Monsanto felt he would prey upon in Hot Meowth's lineup. And it's exactly what has come to pass.
All right, so here we go. Murloc Paladin up against the Zoo Warlock. I personally enjoy this matchup from the Paladin's point of view, just because I like having the abundance of clears. It feels a little more fair version of how the Warrior just has so many clears, too, because you have the Wild Pyromancers, you have the Equality Combinations, Consecrations, compared to Warrior, which seems to have this like a million Whirlwind clears.
And the Pyromancer is quite powerful. Not quite as powerful as it is with Commanding Shout in some spots, but Equality, right. Pretty good too.
Absolutely. Now, Monsanto is playing a slightly different version. I guess you were calling it just like a high, mid-rangey version of it?
Oh, he's playing at least a more mid-rangey version than what he played at Preliminary. At the Preliminary, he had, I believe, double Lay on Hands in his deck.
Right.
And he was playing the super control combo version. Now, the Ivory Knights give him a bit more game just on the board. And that's the sort of thing that can come up big in this kind of matchup.
Yeah, Ivory Knight picks up some of these weird cards that you don't normally see, like Stand Against Darkness, and then all of a sudden you're winning with, like, on the board here.
This spot is actually kind of interesting because Monsanto has two copies of Doomsayer in his hand, and he can coin one of them out here. He could try and wait and you know, maybe get a little bit more value from his Doomsayer if he's able to play it in a future turn. But looking at Hot Meowth's hand, he has the ability to pump up a single minion big enough to kill Doomsayer. If next turn he Demon Fires his Imp, then the following turn he'd be able to just go ahead and Abuse the Sergeant and Lance Carrier it and kill a Doomsayer.
Yeah. So, I mean, he needs to play this Doomsayer because it won't work, but also just from a theoretical point of view, you also do have a turn two play. One of the saddest things you are as a control player playing a Doomsayer is you don't have anything else to do the following turn. In this case, you actually can grab the board, and you also have two Doomsayers, which you can also use the second one as another default option there.
Yeah, Monsanto decides he's just going to go ahead with the tempo play of ensuring that he gets a clear board in turn two, has the Looter to follow up, and now Hot Meowth, Imp Gang Boss, pretty solid so far.
Now, Monsanto picked up Murloc Warleader, trying to evaluate that card versus playing potentially another Doomsayer. It's interesting to think about. Because Doomsayer here complicates turn four, which there are some pretty powerful cards in Hot Meowth's decks, with, like, Defender of Argus, because normally you can bump into the 2-1 Defender of Argus, or playing the Dark Iron Dwarf. Yeah. Although, you know, then the problem becomes, what if he, you know, how he's answered Doomsayer? Are you playing off curve? How does that interact, etc.?
Let me think.
There's also just the Acolyte of Pain has some appeal here to get your, you know, sort of card draw going. Maybe you can find a Pyromancer to help you sort of clear later on. One of the best uses of Doomsayer in this matchup is actually just played after you've already cleared your opponent's board in the sort of mid to late turns of the game to ensure that you get a big board later on. Monsanto just going to go ahead and try and get the tempo Doomsayer here. Hot Meowth does have the tools to get rid of it, though.
Yeah, he does. And you know, it's one of those things where Monsanto's like, you know, hoping that he has to use cards like Soulfire in order to get rid of it. And if so, dump a pretty important card. Like, if you're going to kill a Doomsayer, you have to commit a lot to it. And in this case, it doesn't seem like too much would be lost. Voidwalker, it's not the most useful thing. So it ends up being pretty decent for Hot Meowth.
And one important thing about that exchange was the fact that one of the cards he used was Demon Fire, one of the sort of unique versions of his deck. It stays in terms of its boost. It's not like he just Abusive Sergeanted, and you know, now he has a much more threatening Imp Gang boss. That True Silver Champion won't be able to by itself take out the Imp Gang boss.
Yeah, and that's the whole point of True Silver Champion. It's supposed to 2-for-1 everything. You're trying to kill two cards just with one swing and hopefully climb back onto the board with that. Hot Meowth has just more accelerated damage. He's got Lance Carrier and Abuse the Sergeant for 8. He has to pick up just a two more mana to fill out his curve perfectly. And that is pretty nice. Dark Peddler might even pick up a better option, depending on things like Mortal Coil. Voidwalker, right. Not bad either.
Further protecting that that big boss. That is, in fact, a big, big boss. 6'6".
Wow.
He's been upgraded from Imp Gang boss to Red Infernal now. He's
Yeah, you're right.
He's the Imp Gang overlord here, I think.
Imp Gang CEO.
And you know, this is huge. These permanent buffs on that Imp Gang boss are allowing Hot Meowth to get in repeated big chunks of damage, which is something that the Paladin deck, you know, has answers to. He does have the Equality in his hand, but he'd love to use the Equality in combination with either a Consecration or Wild Pyromancer to get a full board clear.
I do feel like it is okay to use Equality here. You don't want the Imp Gang boss to single-handedly deal 18 damage or more,
yeah,
which might be the case here. Not to mention that you also draw a card, so maybe you can start climbing back there. If you kill off a couple, three minions here, you can get a cheap Solemn Vigil, play one of the three mana minions instead, perhaps. So I don't hate the Equality here.
Yeah, and he's going to go ahead and pull the trigger, clears off the Voidwalker, and that is the end of the reign of the Imp Gang Overlord.
Just for two turns. It was a terrible reign indeed. They'll sing about that for years to come. Hot Meowth has the Abusive Sergeant for the easy trade on the Acolyte. Ooh, Brand Bronzebeard. Interesting. Okay, Direwolf Alpha also an option. Brand Bronzebeard is more mana efficient and stronger on the board, so your opponent can't answer it with a Consecration, for example.
It also sets up, if he draws something like a Defender of Argus next turn, can be absolutely huge in terms of the impact they can have in the game.
Definitely. Still feels like Monsanto is relatively safe, though, and he's drawing his cards in a way that doesn't sabotage him completely either. You know, we've seen Enifin Paladins be stuck with the 10-mana spells with Ragnaros, Light Lord, and Tyrion in hand.
Yeah, the fact that he's picked up both Doomsayers and both Loot Hoarders, even, are pretty important to have at this stage of the game. They allow you to both interact with your opponent's board meaningfully, as well as cycle you through toward those key endgame cards.
So it feels like Monsanto's best options are to play his draw cards, Loot Hoarder and Acolyte, and then try and see if he can hit into something to combine with his Equality, whether it's a Wild Pyromancer or Consecration.
Yeah, it looks like he's leaning toward the War Leader here, wants to just get a bigger body on the board that is not as easily dealt with by Hot Meowth.
Which coincidentally is just like really easily dealt with by a Direwolf Alpha. Or Defender of Argus would be huge too.
That Abusive Sergeant is +4 thanks to Brand.
That's a lot.
Demon Fire, no demons.
Yeah.
It's actually a complete board, almost full, and yet there's not a single demon to be had.
Oh, the Ooh. Consecration on the next draw. So 8 damage, putting his opponent down to 13. Definitely a little uncomfortable for Monsanto, but still a far cry from just death. And this is always one of the most unfortunate things, where your board is just one health away from being clean swept, squeaky clean with a Consecration.
And Monsanto's got to be thinking what the really scary things that could happen if he leaves that Bran up. But at the same time, there's not that many more things. I guess he has both Pyromancers left in his deck. He's already used, I guess, another Consecration too. Just trying to think of the other things he might want to combo that Equality with later on.
Sure.
There's not necessarily that many cards in the Warlock deck that are that big that you really need Equality. It's basically just the Doom Guards that you generally need to Equality down. But I imagine if he does decide to play the Consecration, there's pretty high likelihood he pairs with Equality here.
Yeah, I think you're right. Doom Guard, there's one Dark Iron Dwarf. He doesn't play the Darkshire Councilmans, which everyone tends to really want to remove as well. So I wouldn't hate using it there either.
Yeah, and he is. Equality basically just kills Bran here, but that's good enough for Monsanto, and he does take the full clear on Hot Meowth's board. And Hot Meowth now, with that Demon Fire in hand, really looking for something that, well, does something. He's just got some, picks up a Lance Carrier, and now this is not the scariest of boards just yet. And this is one of the problems with the version that Hot Meowth is playing. It has all these enhancement cards that, while they're powerful if you get the right draw, if you draw them at the wrong time, you can end up in a situation like this where you effectively have dead draws, which that Demon Fire is right now.
Ivory Knight and Bluegill Warrior, a very powerful combination to remove just 5 power onto the board here, so Monsanto can also pick up yet another powerful area of effect. We've seen Enter the Colosseum see play.
Ooh, Avenging Wrath.
Avenging Wrath is also great.
That's a big heal, and Hot Meowth knows that he took a 6-cost card. There are actually 2 6-cost cards that are really problematic, potentially, which are Enter the Colosseum and Avenging Wrath.
Yeah, both are bad. And this is the situation which always is awkward. Demon Fire wants to go onto the Doom Guard, but the Doom Guard will be played first. And now you have to insert the mix of the fact that Soulfire comes out here.
Hoping. Oh, and Hot Meowth keeps the Doom Guard. So definitely a better spot than he would be in if that had been a Demon Fire sitting rotting in his hand.
I mean, this is the time you can just play Avenging Wrath, right? Because you can play Anyfin the following turn.
Mm-hmm. Anyfin the following turn, I believe he's only played the 1 Warleader and the 1 Blue Guy.
Oh, you're right. So it's only 4 damage.
So it's not a particularly big Anyfin. Though, if you play the Loot Hoarder and Avenging Wrath here, you're getting 5 damage to face already, and you have the Loot Hoarder to follow up. You're clearing your opponent's board, which is worth, and getting a body down.
So it'd be 2 off, I think.
Yeah, if Hot Meowth were to life tap, he'd be down to 8. And yeah, exactly 2 damage off lethal with the Anyfin next turn if he does play Loot Hoarder here.
It still feels pretty safe though. You're at 18.
Oh, absolutely.
So I think that even though you're putting your opponent at 2, then, if you draw Consecration, it's lethal. If you draw a second Anyfin, you draw another Blue Goat Warrior.
And the Soulfire getting discarded to Doomguard. If he draws a Malkazar's Imp, it'll be really ironic right here. So it is the Argent Squire.
Yeah, and Monsanto. Ooh,
there's another Anyfin. So Monsanto feels like he's probably healthy enough here that he could just Anyfin and set up for a possible lethal the following turn.
Yeah,
He's already seen both Soulfires and 1 Doomguard. I don't know that there could be a combination of 2 cards, which have to be the other Doomguard that could kill him.
Right, but then you set your opponent at 2, so they can't draw 2 cards.
Right, that's true, yeah. So I think that there's no way if he does he's going to go ahead and trade in, though. Finds a Peacekeeper. I imagine this is going to be Peacekeeper for Forbidden Healing if this is...
That's perfectly fine as well. I mean, going back up to, 27? Mm-hmm. Or it's perfectly fine as well. What are you going to do in this situation if you're the Warlock? You're going to kill yourself before you're able to even threaten your opponent.
Yeah, and there's Argent Horse Rider. Flame Imp is sad in this sort of hand because it represents putting yourself dead to anything can happen. Chooses not to play it. And then anything happens once. And this has got to be terrifying. It's like, okay.
Yeah, at this point, Hot Meowth is doing his due diligence. He's playing out the game just to see if there's any chance, even if it's 0.1%. You'd have to kind of see it through until the last card is drawn, and I don't blame him at all. So Hot Meowth going to tap out here, which means we have a tied series going to game number 7. And all of a sudden, Brian, I got to admit, man, I was feeling a little bit scared that, our unique Anyfin or just the combo lineup in general would be dropping out of the tournament 0-4. But not only is he equalizing the series and making it quite entertaining to the photo finish, but he might even win.
Yeah, this Zudek is really the crux of the lineup here. Monsanto knew coming in that this is what he would prey upon, and that's exactly what's happened.
All right, so we are going to start game number 7 momentarily right after this, guys, so don't go anywhere. Game 7 starts in just a sec. Time for game 7. Winner will move on to day number 2 and keep their dreams alive. Remember, this is the summer season, effectively their last chance to get into BlizzCon this year. So all of it is on the line. We're going to play Druid versus the Zoo Warlock.
And this is the matchup where Monsanto felt the least confident against the Zoo deck. It not only is the...
Or is he? I don't know, I'm reevaluating your statement right now.
Well, if you were down 0-3 and you won 3 in a row, you'd probably be smiling too.
Yeah.
Even if you're queuing into what you thought was not necessarily the best matchup available. And, there's some Wisp of the Old Gods, which are not necessarily the best cards available. Those are going back.
Yeah.
Battle hand, it's going back.
At least you can't draw both of them.
It's true. It's true.
Then I usually get blessed with 2 giants in my hand as well.
Right, well, Monsanto with a pretty good opening here with the Living Roots.
That's not bad at all.
Yeah, no, this is a strong start for the Canadian player. He even has Savage Roar. He's just going to go ahead and Living Roots, Power of the Wild, Savage Roar, just get you. Yeah. Probably not. But it's available.
I mean, it's actually usually not that bad against the Zuwarlok, because your plan as the Druid with Maligos, two Arcane Giants, is to spend your spells, but most importantly, survive.
Well, Monsanto's actually playing the non-Maligos version. He's playing the token-centric version.
Oh, I apologize.
Wisps of the Old Gods and Cenarius. So he has the kind of pre-Karazhan list that he used previously. He actually said that he tried the Maligos version, and that he just didn't have quite as much success with it and decided to go back to the version that he felt more comfortable with.
Okay. Point notwithstanding, the fact is, if you just survive, I think late game you still flex a lot stronger, especially if you have two Wisps of the Old Gods.
Certainly.
In the deck. It's really hard for the Zoo to climb back from that. So Monsanto just has to kind of stall until he gets to that point. In the meantime, he's in an interesting spot if he just wants to use his hero power versus power of the wild. Both have their merits, depending on how he wants to play out his turn three. It doesn't feel like it's imperative to use the power of the wild set for the following turns. In the only instances, I believe his opponent has a mortal coil that he got off the Dark Peddler. And in that case, I like maximizing the value off the hero power, because you don't know if power of the wild gets more useful with other cards like Violet Teacher or Phandral Staghelm.
Yep, looks like Monsanto is going to go ahead and just Power of the Wild, and he is... Oh, wow, he's going face.
Okay.
He's getting you.
So he's willing to trade the 3-2 away, so that way his Savage Roar gets stronger against the influx of smaller minions. However, it does get punished by exactly this. I guess in the end, even in this worst-case scenario, which was specifically a Demon Fire getting a really good trade, and now he gets the value trade on the Dark Peddler, he still gets his hero power down 2-1.
Yeah. It's not really a bad situation at all for Monsanto here, able to ensure that the Zoo does not have at least a board lead going into the middle turns of the game. Generally speaking, the Druid tends to be behind at this stage, and if you're ahead or even, you're generally in a good spot.
Yeah, very good point. Hot Meowth has to play his Imp Gang boss here to just start climbing back. Hopefully he can click value off that 1-1. And lo and behold, you know, Living Roots, one of those cards that's just been super strong and always creeping up in value the more we play with it. Just when we start thinking about when the Grand Tournament first came out, people were all over Darnassus Aspirant. And they were like, oh, that card's insane. But Living Roots has eventually become the best card for Druid from that expansion.
Yeah, Living Roots is fantastic. And one of the big reasons is that it gives Druid deck something proactive to do on turn one. The fact that you can use your mana on the first turn, and that mana can effectively interact with your opponent's turn one or even their turn two,
right.
Even if they have nothing in play already, that's huge. Just because mana utilization is such a key element of being able to be successful in tempo-based games of Hearthstone.
Yep. Removal damage as well, which combos with Maligos, finishing Reach with Living Root Swipe. Also, the fact that you can play it and Giant in the same turn, in most cases. Chooses to ramp for, or not, sorry, not ramp, sorry, summon the minion. Monsanto seems to like doing this a lot with his decks.
Yeah, he is just fighting for the board here. I imagine his perspective is that if he is able to contest the board now, he'll be able to win when they get to the late game. He wants to ensure that he's not falling behind, and Hot Meowth will dig with that. Peddler finds a Mortal Coil. He doesn't quite have... Well, he can Mortal Coil the Sapling. Oh, I didn't even realize that he had an Imp there. I saw the Mortal Coil, and there's... Yes, Mortal Coil, or rather Soulfire with the Imp, allows him to upgrade that Lowly Squire into a Lance Carrier.
Yeah.
And now he is the one who is very much ahead in this board.
Yeah, it's very much, it's a lot better because you have to weigh what's the value of like one card that you draw through a Mortal Coil versus the draw that you get while putting a 1-3 on the board. And this Malkazar's Imp is very, very strong.
Yeah, this is huge.
So Monsanto, how do you respond to this? You have Saboteur Wrath as this turn. That's actually not that terrible either, because you can remove a decent amount from the board. Even choosing to Wrath for a card is also an option, so that way you can develop your options, because you have really expensive cards like Arcane Giant, Yogg-Saron, and Nourish is pretty expensive as well. You need better plays over the next few turns before you can get to that inevitable point where you want to play Giants and Yogg-Saron.
Yeah, Monsanto definitely looking to fight back this turn. It's really crucial for the Druid that they don't fall behind too far in these early turns so they can actually survive to the stage that they can play those late-game cards like Yogg-Saron. Ooh, picks up a swipe, man. That could be crucial on future turns.
Yeah, I'm as this, the game continues to develop, I'm starting to feel like Druid's become, you know, very safe. He has swipe now to kind of back up whatever buffed minion usually comes his way, and if he can get the giant out and then ultimately Yogg-Saron, he's in a really good spot, assuming that Hot Meowth doesn't completely bully the board the next two turns here.
All right, well, there is a big attack from this Lance Carrier getting quite a bit of damage in, though Monsanto has a swipe to take care of it. Unfortunately, that swipe can't clear off the rest of the board because it is protected by that Voidwalker. A lot of three health minions floating around for Hot Meowth.
Yeah, I'm looking for alternative plays. You know, you're always looking at a way to get Nourish out because it's much more effective out of your hand being played than in. So can he do something fancy with ramping? Can he do something with drawing cards? But it just seems like swipe's the better option here to make sure you don't lose too much life.
It's really difficult to leave a six attack minion up. We're again seeing these Lance Carriers, the fact that they leave a permanent buff on that minion, really forcing Monsanto into an awkward position this turn.
Yep. Because if not, then these Lance Carriers have added 4 damage apiece, which in that case, sign me up for whatever the 1-2 does. It's fantastic damage. Hot Meowth also has follow-up with the Dark Iron Dwarf. Or if he picks up Abusive Sergeant, Brand Bronzebeard, now that he sees a swipe. And he's choosing to take damage so that he can remove one extra minion.
This is commitment for Monsanto here. Wants to make sure he gets the most off the board as possible. Take 6 damage from that.
Wow. I mean, those Lance Carriers did work.
Yeah.
And now Dark Iron Dwarf adds to it. We already saw a swipe. What are the chances he has a second one? It's pretty low. And Monsanto, did he play too greedy?
He picks up a Wrath. He has Feral Rage. Is he able to, he can nourish. He can't quite nourish for mana and play both Wrath and Feral Rage. So he can't set up for Yogg next turn, as well as play those removal spells. He could just play Nourish and Feral Rage and not bother with the Wrath to just set himself up.
He could just put
himself up at 19. And we saw Monsanto in the preliminary in a spot where he recognized, you know, this is a game that I'm not going to win unless I praise the God of Death. And this might be looking like it's getting to that spot. He hasn't played that many spells, though, and that was exactly the position he was in last time, though.
Specifically, okay, on the previous episode of the Hearthstone Championship Tour, Monsanto was going up against Dude 7597, who did end up winning his previous match for people tuning in late. And it was specifically this matchup. It was Zoo Warlock up against Druid. And Monsanto was in a pretty bad spot. And I think he's catched on to the fact that he might need to once again.
That is exactly what we're seeing.
We're
seeing ramp to Yogg, Feral Rage, try and stay alive. Praise him.
And if there's one thing that I've learned in my time of getting straight B's in high school is that history tends to repeat itself, Gibbler.
Those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it. We shall see what shall come.
Yep.
This is a lot of damage from Hot Meowth here. Mm-hmm. Not quite lethal. He is setting Monsanto down to just 6, and we see both players kind of grinning. What's going to happen?
Are they grinning or are they grimacing? We'll find out in just a few seconds here. Monsanto is looking for one thing, and that one thing only, and that's board clear. It doesn't even matter about drawing cards because he's got a lot of resources. Arcanature could taunt a big minion. Not that one.
These are not quite cutting it here. Oh, that could have been on his own face and killed him.
Yeah. And no, that's it.
The God of Death does not come through for Monsanto once again, and Hot Meowth advances to the semifinals.
Live by the Yogg, die by the Yogg. Monsanto did his best to do it once again, but Hot Meowth prevails, sending the Canadian home. A job well done to Hot Meowth, as it looked kind of scary, you know, being up 3-0 and then bringing it all the way back to 3-3 is quite the tense situation. But once again, being able to qualify, he's going to face Dude tomorrow in the semifinals.
Yeah, definitely, you know, quite the match. It looked like it was going to be very one-sided, and Monsanto definitely made Hot Meowth sweat down to the final Yogg. But
our Yoggs today have been very close to turning it, and then just nothing happens, and the person who's ahead ends up winning.
Yep.
There you go. Hot Meowth, their second semifinalist here for the summer season. Let's head over to the fireside for a few words with our winner.
Thank you, Frodan. I am joined by the winner of match number two. It is Hot Meowth. Congratulations, first of all. That was an incredible series. You went up very quickly with three games in a row and then lost three following that because of your Zoo deck. Now, I just have to ask, that was a really interesting take on the Zoo Warlock. Why did you choose to bring this build?
That build is not my build. It's Mazi's build. I'm early in the season this month. It's still experimental, so it's still kind of iffy to bring. I kind of practice it with Dart, so I think it's an alright deck, but like obviously like he has Freeze Mage and Rogan, which is pretty good against my Zoo deck. And I think like it all came down to game four, like who plays Yawk like hard enough. So I guess my Druid was better than him because like I played Yawk like better yesterday.
Well, congratulations, Hot Meowth. You are moving on to the semifinals tomorrow. And we are going to be right back very soon with our next match. It's going to be Pascua versus Rooftrap.